Welcome to episode 12 of the Fruity Knitting Podcast. I'm Andrea.
And I'm Andrew, and we're broadcasting today from our Offenbach studio.
We're Australians living in Germany as expats, and we live in a small city called Offenbach, which is actually really close to the centre of Frankfurt. So if you jump into a train, it takes you 12 minutes. And coming from Melbourne, to us, that means we live in an inner suburb of Frankfurt.
But in Germany, here in Offenbach and in Frankfurt, they're culturally two very different places, and that's a very important distinction.
Absolutely. And Offenbachers do not think of themselves as being inner suburb Frankfurters.
Yeah.
Okay, so today we have a great program for you. Our knitter from the Knitter of the World is coming from the top of Scotland in Angus. We have some good progress happening with the Firebirds and the hiking jacket. I've survived my 50 bobbin intarsia ordeal, so I'm really excited to show you that. And we've got a really brilliant and inspiring interview with Felicity Ford from KNITSONIK.
Good.
So we move on to under construction. And under construction, I'll start off with my Firebirds. Last episode, I showed you the pattern with this cute little girl here. The pattern is by Jade Starmore, and it was originally a child's cardigan, and then she adapted it to be a woman's cardigan, and I'm adapting it to be a gentleman's jumper. And I also told you in the previous episode the legend of the Firebird, and that's the inspiration for this design. I have now knitted 16 Firebirds. And I have approximately 140 to knit. That's based on the calculations that I hopefully I've got right. So I actually have a question for you, Andrew.
Yeah.
Each Firebird, so a Firebird has 19 stitches across and 29 rows in it. So how many stitches are in a Firebird?
How many stitches? Well, that would make 551 stitches.
Right.
For a Firebird.
Okay, good. And I have approximately 140. So how many stitches, roughly, is going to be in your jumper?
140.
Yes.
At 551 age.
Yes. Come on, quick.
I think that would be 77,140.
Right. Okay, you can check up and let us know in the comments.
You're following along at home.
If he's got it right. So I think that's a pretty... And how many jumpers have I knitted you in total?
Five?
Yes.
Five.
Okay, so...
That was a hard one.
Five times...
375,740.
Yes. 385,700. Right, you can check up on him. I actually think that that's a pretty good example of my dedication and devotion to you.
I see. That's what this
as shown this in the amount
is for.
Yes, as shown in the amount of stitches I have knitted for you.
Okay, so it's per stitch.
Per stitch.
This is the row and two ply, isn't it?
No. This is Alice Starmore, Hebridean.
It's a two ply. Hebridean. Sure.
Yeah. Sorry. And most of the jumpers Hebridean I knit you, they're not chunky. They're fine.
Well, that. But, if you do then move
don't
to
take
it.
Away from the great gift I've given you.
No, that's very impressive. That's two-ply love, you know.
Yes, two-ply love.
But that means if you move up to a sort of thicker yarn.
Yeah, that I love you less per jumper. Yeah. Okay. Anyway, we should move on. So I want to tell you a little bit about how I'm constructing this. My handsome man here, as I said before, has got broad shoulders.
Is that one for me?
Yes.
Okay. I always get thrown by the gentleman.
Okay. Well, my handsome gentleman husband has got broad shoulders and narrow hips. So whenever I knit him a jumper, I tend to do a reverse A-line in style.
Do you want to zoom in on the broad shoulders?
No. Okay. So what I've done here is because it's a little tricky I don't want to mess up the pattern of the Firebirds by doing increases. I want to try to avoid that. So I'm trying to do this slight A-line look by simply just changing up my needle size. So I've started off the band in 2.5 millimeter, and then I've done the very first section of Firebirds. Do you want to hold it for me?
Yeah, of course.
Thank you.
It's being the least a gentleman. I can do. Yeah.
From here to here is one round of Firebirds. So that section here I've done in a 2.75 millimeter. Now I'm on 3 millimeters, and I possibly might extend to 3.25 up here, or 3.5 even. We'll see. I haven't decided whether I'm going to do a drop shoulder, which might be good anyway, because it gives you a bit more space or room, or if I do a set-in sleeve, or even a modified drop shoulder. So that part of the pattern I haven't figured out yet. But I am very proud to say that I've started. I think it's gorgeous. I love the wool. I love the Firebirds. Yeah, so.
Yep. Can we mention the comment that we got?
Oh, yes. One of our viewers.
We just have to grab this again. All right, so this is the original pattern. Watching the glare there, I think it's visible. I thought you were going to say sweet little girl here wearing a cardigan. One of our viewers left a comment saying, Andrea, if you can turn that into a jumper that your husband is happy to wear, you are a genius.
I'm taking you up on that challenge.
The challenge is on. I'm also, I mean, it's.
And you will be obliged to wear it with a smile on your face.
It's actually a team effort here, because you have to make it and I have to wear it.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay. So how's your hiking jacket?
Yeah, look, I'm quite impressed with your progress there, Dolph. Mm-hmm. It's really good.
Mm-hmm. You
know? But I have to hold up mine. Mine all wraps up. Look at that. Hang on. Let's just do it a bit side by side. So I've done as much as you.
Yes.
See? I've done as much as you. So this is my hiking jacket. If you're joining us. Yeah, could you hold this
for me? Yes. Thanks. Even though I won't wear it.
This is my hiking jacket. If you're joining us for the first time, welcome. And, we've talked about this before. We saw that we started it and did a little bit of planning. This is a jacket that's going to be for me. This is my first major garment. I've made 2 pairs of socks.
And one hat.
1.5 hats.
Yes.
And remade one hat. And then a scarf, which nobody's seen. And so this is my first serious piece of work. I'm really impressed with how it's going. I have been paying a lot of attention to my tension.
I'll move it around again.
I had to prepare that. Did you like that?
Yes.
Yeah, good. because my tension, it's funny, this wool, when I was doing the other, knitting the socks, the tension was just perfect all the time and I really didn't have to think about it. But doing this, I noticed that, and I think this is fairly typical, my knit rows are really tight and my purl rows are really loose. So I didn't want that to go on. So I got some consulting from Andrea, and I've sort of, what I've found
at
for the
$2
purl,
an hour.
Yeah. And 7 stitches an hour. What I've found is when I'm doing the purl, what I was doing was grabbing the needles. I sort of need some security when I'm doing knitting so it doesn't go all wrong. So I was grabbing the needles. That was all really safe. But that somehow, I don't understand why this is happening, but it ended up making the stitches really loose. Even though I was pulling it to try and make it tight, it just didn't work. And what I found that does work is I grab the actual work, which makes it a little bit less secure for me, but it means that whatever I'm doing, whatever else I'm doing, the stitches come out tight enough and the tension is pretty good. There's still a difference between the knit and the purl, but it's much better. And it's just interesting to see that this wool is, for me, it needs a lot more attention in that way. The wool is, and again, we mentioned this, I think, on episode 10.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We spoke to a couple of people from the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust. They've got sheep, a flock of Hebridean sheep. Hebridean?
Yeah. Conservation,
yeah,
they're so using for conservation.
They're grazing it on conservation lands, which is a really cool thing to sort of use sheep to help look after the environment. So this wool's from them. It's undyed and it's quite a raw wool. It's wool. It's really nice. This is going to be a jacket, so it's a really nice outer layer. We've got this sort of contrast color thing, and I've got in the program notes from episode 11, you can see a full description of what we did here, which I think is really cool, folding it over and the little contrast and the details on how that's done. This other wool here for the contrast color matches really well with the Hebridean from the Yorkshire Wildlife Trust.
Yeah, so this is 50% Hebridean, 50% alpaca.
Alpaca.
And this is...
this is the Rowan Hemp Tweed.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the colour's great. I love the colour. And the wool just mixes in perfectly. So that's that. So it's coming along and I'm really happy with how it's going. It would be really nice if I got to wear that this winter.
In Snowdonia,
yes. We shall see if I manage that.
Our interview today is in two parts because it's slightly longer than normal. So we're very excited to present part one of the interview with Felicity Ford from KNITSONIK.
I live in Reading with my cat and my man, and I love it there, but I do hope I can return here often to listen to terns, to go up on the peat hills and hear the burns, to visit the wool brokers and huff the wool fumes, listen to shimmer machines record the looms, and revel in knowing that the Shetlanders are still rocking the world with amazing textiles that, unlike in some other parts of the UK, the wool industry here is still thriving today. That people here still know that knitwear is hip, so the crofter can earn some money for the clip. And if places were graded and sorted like wool, then Shetland would be an ace, 1 star and 4 marks. And I am so happy to be here to share this wonderful textile that we should all wear.
Welcome to the Fruity Knitting Podcast. I'm so excited because today we've got a super interesting guest on the podcast. Some of you may already know her through her work with the Shetland Wool Week, which is an annual wool festival in Shetland, or through her recently published book, The KNITSONIK Stranded Colourwork Sourcebook. Yes, I've got Felicity Ford with me today. And apart from being an enthusiastic knitter and designer, Felicity is also a sound artist and an academic. And she's an incredibly creative person who thinks very much outside of the box. Felicity is greatly inspired by the little things and the little details in life. And this is a central theme that just runs through her work. I really love this about her, and I also find it extremely inspiring. So welcome, Felicity, and thank you so much for agreeing to be on the podcast.
It's very nice to be here, and thanks for that lovely introduction.
Let's start perhaps with a description of how you became a sound artist and how you became a knitter, and what it is about both of these two things individually that you really love so much. And then how easy has it been for you to unite two of them together to make a sort of a unified passion?
Well, it's quite straightforward in a way, because I was doing an MA in sonic art and composition, and I had moved to Oxford to do that at Oxford Brookes University. And I was a bit like, this is a new city. I don't know anybody here. Where am I going to meet the quality women? And I was thinking maybe I could join some kind of group or find some people doing something creative. And I saw an advert for the Oxford Blue Stockings knitting group, and I went along to that, and I just instantly kind of fell in love with what it was. It was a really special knitting group. They still meet actually every Wednesday in Oxford, and all of the women who were there seemed to be in these amazing jobs working at Oxford University Press, and they were all producing these things that just to me looked impossibly complicated, and I was so instantly inspired. And I found everyone was quite kind of competitive and opinionated, and we're all talking about blogs and podcasts, which I had never heard of then. And I just felt like, wow, this is really a very rich context that I've found myself in. So I was, during the day, learning about kind of experimental composition and learning how to record sounds, and then by night kind of going on the internet and like looking at patterns and learning about yardage and gauge and all of these things. And I suppose I got very interested in how at one point, like, these things were just in my life, and I find this often happens with artists, the stuff that's around an artist ends up being in their work. And I had this idea that I want to knit a speaker system and play everyday sounds through it. And so I got my brother to show me how do you solder a speaker, and to sort of teach me the maths of how many speakers will I need and how will I wire them and how will they work with my amp and all of that. And when I was kind of soldering the speakers, people were saying, you know, that's very technical. And then meanwhile, I was also learning how to knit socks. And I thought that actually knitting a sock is more technical and more complicated than soldering a speaker. But somehow knitting was not being framed as something technical. Whereas like if it's to do with wires and electricity, then it's technical. And if it's to do with knitting, then it's not technical. And I thought that was a really interesting thing to kind of explore. So the first stuff that I was doing was like, I was experimenting with all sorts of things. Like there's a famous composition called I Am Sitting in a Room by Alvin Lucier. And that is about, it's a text that says, I am sitting in a room similar to the one that you're sitting in here. And there's more to it than that, but you record it. Then you play the sound of it back in the room and record the recording playing in the room. And then you record the recording of the recording play. So it's like a photocopy of a photocopy of a photocopy of a photocopy of a sound. And over time, the words completely dissolve and you're just left with the resonant frequencies of the room as a kind of tone. And it always gets cited as this really seminal, amazing work by this kind of genius male composer. And I just had this mischievous feminist idea to recast it as I am knitting in a room. And so I had these massive knitting needles and I was amplifying the sounds and recording the sounds. It didn't sound very good. But it was a kind of interesting beginning in sort of exploring those two worlds. And then this knitted speaker system, I covered 32 miniature speakers, each about that size, in a little knitted cozy. And then I covered all the wires with I-cord and I recorded all these very domestic sounds and played them through them. And it was such a like failed piece, if you like, which I think is always really useful in creative process. And I kept thinking, no, I am onto something with this, but I don't really know kind of exactly how to resolve it. And I did resolve it a little bit later on, which I'll get to in one of your other questions. But it kind of, it started with those things. And then the more that I've developed, I suppose, as a knitter, and the more that my understanding of the context of sheep and wool and yarn and the sort of social history of knitting as well, the more that those aspects of my knitting practice have kind of evolved, and the more that as a sound artist I've firmed up what it is I'm really interested in, the easier it's been to kind of synthesize them together. And now it's my entire thing is KNITSONIK, knitting and sound, and bringing those together.
It was only as an adult you became more acquainted with country life, wasn't it? Because you were originally brought up in the country or in the city. And so I suppose as an adult you got more of a connection to how agriculture plays such a strong role in our lives. Tell us how that happened and how that affects you as well. Like, what was your first experience of getting to know the country life?
Well, I think that's a really important point, because when I joined the Oxford Blue Stockings, it was a very kind of urban context, if you like. We were meeting in a city, everyone had these kind of academic jobs, and, you know, these kind of boutique yarns that we were buying from like John Lewis and other kind of high street stores were like tended to be a mixture of polyfiber and polyester and acrylic and microfiber and cashmere and all of these kinds of things. And it was when I was doing the write-up for my MA, I decided to stay somewhere. I just need to be somewhere really quiet, away from the noise and distraction and internet of the city. So I booked to stay in this place called The Studio in Sussex. And when I was firming up the details for that, I got this email back and the address was at Woolcraft with Wensleydale. And I was like, oh, I guess there's something to do with wool in this place. And so I went there and we got talking, and Julia Desch, who runs that project, Woolcraft with Wensleydale, sort of said to me, would you like to see the wool room? And I was like, yes, I think I would. And, you know, we went out and she was showing me these absolutely gorgeous skeins of Wensleydale worsted yarn that had been like spun maybe 10 miles away in a little micro mill in Sussex. And then obviously outside, the whole time I was staying there, there were her sheep. And I was like, I've never, and I sort of had this light bulb moment, which seems so ridiculous now, but I kind of looked at her and I said, you know, so does all the yarn that like I buy in the shops, has that just come from sheep on a farm kind of like this here? And she was like, yeah, no. And we got into this massive discussion. I can't remember how much the skein of yarn was, but I remember I was a bit like, wow, that's quite a lot of money. And she was like, well, and she sort of explained the specialist diet that the Wensleydales need, the amount of labour that goes into producing these animals, the fact that all of the labour that goes into her flock is happening in the UK, where we have a minimum wage and where we have a higher living wage to attain in order to survive. So it's not all being processed overseas where people get like 5p a week. It's a completely different, and suddenly my mind was blown, and I was just like, I just don't understand where textiles come from. And I said to her, you know, do you mind if I come back and make recordings of your farm? Because I produce radio shows for this amazing long-standing field recording show called Framework Radio. And I said, I'd really like to do a radio show that in sound tells the whole story of yarn growing, first of all, on the back of a sheep, then being scoured and spun at the mill, and then being wound into hanks, and then being knitted, and then being worn. And I was like, how, like, somehow that invisible story that had been completely invisible to me, that I had not understood, suddenly became visible. And I felt like sound was an amazing way to tell that story, because it's time-based and you can hear how long things take. And I think that gives an extra presence and texture to the work that goes into making wool. So that was the start of the glorious foray into understanding the sort of backstory of wool. And from that point, then I've done other projects in... So then I did a project in the Lake District, and remember I was talking about the knitted speakers that I covered in like garish acrylic wool. I sort of, after doing this radio show for Julia Desch, with Julia Desch's Sheep Sounds, I was like, you know what, I really want to make, well, actually I was invited to show the knitted speakers at an exhibition called The Wonders of Wool at Reged. In Cumbria, and I wrote to the organisers and said, I can't allow you to show the knitted speakers in their current form, because they're not covered in wool, they're covered in acrylic, and like you have to pay me to recover them in 100% British wool, and like wool from the Lake District. And you know, if I can interview shepherds, and if I can like make recordings on the farms where that wool is grown, then you can have my knitted speakers in your piece. So that is what I did. I recovered the knitted speakers in British wool, and I went round and I recorded all the different sounds of Cumbrian farms, and then I kind of mixed them together and had all these amazing interviews with shepherds talking about growing wool in the Lake District. And Bridget Kelly from the Wool Marketing Board, when she saw and heard the piece, she said, this piece is like listening to wool. And so I thought, this is great, this is exactly what I was intending. And so I felt like I'd resolved some of the things that were a bit more unresolved earlier when I made it out of acrylic. And then I suppose I had this question, which was like, when I was doing the Lake District project, I felt really strongly that there was this amazing relationship between the specific textiles of the Lake District and the terroir, or the sense of place in Cumbria. So the sheep breeds that are really famous there, like the Rough Fell and the Swaledale and the North England Mule and the Herdwick, are really, they're animals that are particularly suited to that landscape, and they're suited to a kind of common, like to a common grazing practice, and they all can survive on the High Fell, which is a quite mountainous, hostile, not super comfy environment. And they have these incredible, like particularly Herdwick and Rough Fell have these amazing character fleeces that are very sturdy, and they have good prickle factor, and they're very almost like architectural. I love these fleeces. And when you see like the stones and the rocks in the Lake District, and then you see Herdwick fleeces, the exact same colour, and they're so obviously of that place. And when you record things like, you know, the creaky gates, the high wind, the muddy puddles, the collie dogs, all of these sounds that are so particular to that farming context, then for me that sounds, it's really particular. There's a sense of place in the yarn and in the sounds. And I thought, you know, maybe this is silly and I'm just being fanciful. So I applied for a residency to go to Estonia. I went to Estonia, and then I was looking at, again, is there a specific soundscape here that's particular to here that connects with the sheep that are grown here. And it was really interesting because in Estonia they have a very different, there's some things, for example, there are wolves in Estonia, so all of the shepherds I visited had these massive Maremma dogs, which are these enormous, really barking, giant, I think they're Italian, the Maremma sheep dogs, but the sound of them and the sound of them barking and the sound of them kind of their protective instincts towards the flock is something I never heard in the UK. And then there tends to be a lot of forested land. They don't have the same exact kind of square fields with hedges around them that we have kind of in the UK. And like, I got all these amazing recordings of cranes calling to each other and all these incredible birds and kind of singing very, very close to where sheep graze and having a little bit more of a feeling of the forest and the sheep together. And it was really interesting to see I can do something with this sense of place and textiles. And so then I went to Shetland to I was the patron for Shetland Wool Week in 2013. I did a project called Listening to Shetland Wool. And again, that was all about what sounds are really particular. Like, what sounds can we listen to that will help us to understand this very, very particular textile that is Shetland wool? And it's amazing because the simplest way to describe it is that you are never further than a mile from the shore, which in the abstract, you kind of get that. But when you listen to field recordings and you can hear sheep baaing and you can hear terns and oyster catchers and gulls all coexisting in the same soundscape, then you really understand the dual kind of history of crofting, which was knitting from the land and fishing from the sea. And you can hear that in the sounds. And I think, yeah, so that's kind of, that's how I've learned about agricultural practices through knitting and sound. Sorry, it's a really long answer, but
that's such a beautiful description though. And I can just visualize it now as you're explaining it. But let's talk more about the farming community, because recording sounds is a artistic and rather academic pursuit. And I'm just wondering how you went with communicating your intentions to the very practical and perhaps less academic farming community. And did you have any funny stories that are related to that?
Loads of funny stories. And I think one thing is that I was a bit trepidatious the first time. Like, it's always a bit nerve-wracking phoning someone up and being like, I'm a sound artist and I'm a knitter and I really want to record the sounds of your sheep. And can I come and do that? And usually there's like a long pause. But what I've really discovered is that we have a material in common, which is wool. And the fact that I'm very, very passionate about wool and the fact that, you know, sheep farmers are very passionate about wool and they have a lot of opinions and things to say about wool. And that usually the kind of, we can usually connect on that. And so it hasn't been too difficult, and people are amazingly generous and helpful. But some of my funny stories, like, I guess the first time I went to record sheep, I was not prepared for the fact that I would walk into the field and they would all just run away, because I'm like walking along with a massive microphone, which looks slightly weapon-like.
Yes.
And they're just like, they are prey in the food chain of things. So they all tend to just run away. So I have got a lot of, and then I suppose the creative strategies that I've developed to get around that is to sort of ask the shepherd, you know, can we go together to see the sheep? Because that usually works. If there's a bucket of food, the sheep will come. I've learned this. And also there is like some of the more primitive breeds, like the little Hebridean sheep, which have, sometimes they have like six horns. They're these like really small, amazing multi-horned sheep. And they're very wily, and by all accounts, you cannot get a dog around them. They go to four corners. You can't fence them in. They escape. I really love them. They're so mischievous and cunning. And so trying to record these amazing rams when I was in the Lake District, I ended up the only way to record them was to bury my recorder in the hay bale and then just leave. So it was in the hay bale, and it's one of the most beautiful recordings I've ever made, because they came over to their, it's like a metal kind of feeding trough, and it has bars and a roof, and then the hay with my recorder in it. And as they were eating from it, their horns were banging against the bars. So in a way, it was kind of like it was a kind of sheep horn percussion. And that was, I don't know if that's funny, but I think it's funny that they just run away whenever I try and record them. And also when I was in Cumbria, it was in January, and it was quite, which is the end of tupping season. So they've, and I don't know how much you know about the sheep breeding, but basically you have a couple of rams, but probably just one ram that will service your entire flock of ewes. And that's how you kind of ensure the genetic kind of consistency of the animals. And by January, like that tends to start around October. And I really hadn't thought this through, but by January, the rams look absolutely haggard. Like, and really like thin and just not at their best at all. And I didn't even think about that because I was just like, oh, can I record the rams and can I record the ewes? And that was all fine. But then I said, oh, can I take a few pictures for my blog? And the stricken faces of these farmers, loads of them have got, these are show flocks that they go and they show, these are like the pedigree animals. And they were very unhappy. They were like, do not take pictures of my animals when they're not in peak physical condition. Yes. And I thought that was funny, but I also thought it was really instructive about the sort of the labour and the pride that goes into these flocks of sheep.
Absolutely.
And also in the Lake District, I was interviewing this shepherd and he was telling me there's a book for all of the shepherds who farm in Cumbria, because a lot of the land is common land. So to differentiate their flocks, they'll take a little nick out of the ears of the sheep, or they'll, and they have a special mark called a smit mark that goes on their fleece. And there's a book that shows you all of these different variations, and it is basically a sheep repeated over and over again with little either different nicks out of its ears or a different mark on its back. And when I was interviewing George Harriman, he was saying, I said, you know, when did you know that you wanted to be a shepherd? And he was like, I think my parents had an inkling when they discovered that I'd coloured in the Smith Mark book. I just thought it's so beautiful. We'd just gone through and coloured in all the sheep.
It's got KNITSONIK on it. It's got KNITSONIK on it.
So that was part one of the KNITSONIK interview, and I thoroughly enjoyed doing that. And I thought it was really great, again, being reminded about how important the sense of sound is. And I also thought it was interesting to compare the sound of Estonia with the thrush and the foresty sounds, and the Estonian language that you heard coming through in those dogs is so different from the Shetland, where you heard the sea and the wind and the seagulls. And you can, if you listen to it, you can really hear their different places. And it's a little bit like when you hear it on a good audio book or a radio play, and you can hear the clipping of hooves or someone walking on a pavement, it really ignites the imagination a lot more. And it also reminded of me of, because we don't get back to Australia very often, but one time after spending a long time away from Australia, coming back and waking up the next morning, I was woken up to a warbling magpie. And magpies in Australia have a beautiful song, unlike any magpies over here in the Northern Hemisphere. And it just sort of hit me in the heart. And I didn't realize how much I missed the sound of these birds, you know, and how important it was for me, and how the sound just evoked so much emotion.
Yep.
Yeah.
We actually managed to fit in some magpies into one of our early episodes. I think it's episode 3.
Yeah.
Where we've got the Australian magpies. Because, I found it a funny thing. Sound is a neglected sense, and it sort of has, in one way, it has a very important role, but in other ways, it's just ignored, you know, in our normal day-to-day life. So
we'll continue on with part 2 of the interview. But before that, here is our Knitters of the World.
I'm Jeni Reid, and I'm a knitter and a spinner and a photographer, and I come from Angus in the northeast of Scotland, but I'm in Dundee today in my local yarn store, which is fluff. I like knitting because it's a thing that connects me with my family, because I come from a family of spinners and weavers and shepherds on my mum's side and on my dad's side, which is really nice. And the knitting and the spinning are things that I love the fact that I can do it, and it's exactly the same thing that my ancestors did hundreds or so years ago. I also like the fact that you can put it in a bag and do it on the train, or if you're a passenger in a car, and it's a lovely way just to get lost in making something, and then once you've finished, you've hopefully got something useful at the end of it, which is important. It's been a great way of meeting people, and I spend a lot of time going to yarn festivals, like the Edinburgh Yarn Festival or Shetlands for Wool Week. A very thoughtful kind of group of people in knitting who take it just that wee bit further and think about the clothes that we wear and who makes them and why we should be just a little bit more aware of the sacrifices other people make so that we can have clothes. So there's a lot of thought goes into knitting patterns, and I like the fact that I can create something that's absolutely my own. This is one of my early bits of hand spun. It's a single ply blue face Leicester tops with, I think it's onion skin dye, and it's a pattern called Bactus, which is a really simple pattern. And this is not complicated at all, but I love it, and it means a lot to me because it's one of my very early pieces of hand spun. And you can just do it around your neck in any shape you like, and it's lovely. And another pair, or a pair, of other things. These are socks that I knitted in patterns from Mary Jane Buckleston's Book of Fairy Isle Designs. And I hardly ever wear them because I'm terrified that they're going to wear out. But they're probably one of the most popular things on my Ravelry project page, and people seem to love them. And I like to put them in a frame. And then we have Pingolin, the penguin, who is a design by the ace penguin designer Anna Maltz. And I was really lucky to be a test knitter for her Book of Penguin Designs. And he's slightly bigger than the average pingolin because he's made from hand spun. And the great thing about this is it's all the same fleece. The only bit I dyed was his beak, because it was a Jacob fleece and they're spotty. And it's a fabulous pattern to knit because you learn all sorts of things about short rows and garments that come on and off, and it's just magic. And he has eyes made from lapis lazuli, which were tremendously special. But it's a great pattern for learning techniques, and at the end of it you get the most amazing penguin. Ooh. This is a hat designed by Trudy Seerstad, who I met at Shetland Wool Week a couple of years ago, and we had a conversation about the lack of pink and orange and red in knitting. And so when I got a hold of this pattern, I was determined to use pink and orange and red. I think it's mostly either Jameson & Smith jumper weight 4-ply or Elemental Effects, which is a Californian yarn, Shetland as well. And it's just a really lovely hat because it keeps your ears warm, and I've been out in really high winds and it never ever blows away. This is my final favourite knitted thing, which hasn't been knitted yet. And that's because one of my favourite things about knitting is the planning and the thinking about what you're going to do with the yarn that you've got. And I spend many happy hours looking at books and Ravelry trying to work out what to do next. And that's probably the thing I like best about knitting. It's the time that you can spend, even if you're not knitting, you can sit and plan and think about all the amazing things that you're going to make one day. All the yarn that you have in your attic or under your bed or in bags of fleece like I have.
I'm laughing because I've got fleece in the basement.
And that's the end.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jeni Reid. That was lovely to hear a little bit of a Scottish accent.
Yeah. And I actually looked up, you mentioned that Jeni Reid was from Angus in Scotland, not quite at the northern tip, but up towards the north. And I had a look because our family name, if you follow my father's back in time, is Doig. Doig is most definitely a Scottish name. It comes from the clan of the dog. And my family actually came from a place called Kilrenny in Fife, which is about 50 miles away from where
Angus.
Jeni is, from Angus, yeah. So my family, that's some time ago, they moved out in 1835. They took the boat out to Australia. I think I might be missing a great here, but I think my great-great-grandfather took the ship out to Australia. I think he was accompanied because, if I'm getting it all right, he was 4 years old, which is pretty brave. These people were pretty brave.
They were fishermen, weren't they?
Yeah, and so they were fishermen there, and they moved out to Australia. This is around the time of the gold rush, so possibly they were heading out to try and make their fortune on the gold. I saw I'm not sure of the greats, but I think it was my great-great-grandfather was a teacher.
Okay.
And my grandfather, was a very interesting man. He was a footballer, or he was head of the captain of the football team at college and captain of the cricket team. I actually looked up on Wikipedia. I Googled his name and he was on Wikipedia, and I had a look at the Wikipedia entry, and the Wikipedia entry lists him as an Australian Football League player. So
wow.
I think for a very short period of time he did play National Football League in Australia.
But he was also a doctor.
That's what I found a little bit funny. It didn't quite give a full picture of him because he was a doctor and served in France in the war. But he also founded what I believe is the first community hospital in Australia, in Colac, which is a little country town. So
I'm going to insert a picture of him here because he looks very similar to Andrew when Andrew had more hair. If Andrew ever grows his hair out, it's extremely curly and it's actually in beautiful ringlets. That's what first attracted me to him.
Right.
And you can actually see, what was his name?
My grandfather?
Yeah.
Keith McKeddy Doig.
Keith McKeddy Doig.
Yes.
Okay. He has these
Sounds a bit Scottish.
Slightly. He has these beautiful black curly ringlets as well.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think he was an all-round high achiever, wasn't he?
Pretty high performer, yeah. I mean, this is something else that I thought. You follow this one line, you know, it's kind of the easy line to follow when you're looking at your ancestry, but that's only one little part of it, you know.
Yeah.
There are all the women on the other side, all the way down there in a whole tree. So,
But I think yours is pretty intensely.
There are quite a few Doigs in my...
Yes, on both sides.
you could say there's one more Doig than maybe there should be, but that's okay.
Yes.
Yep.
Okay.
So thank you to Jeni. And I also have to say thank you to Jenny's assistant and to Oscar.
The dog.
The dog.
The gorgeous, relaxed dog on the couch. Yeah. Okay. So we're back onto under construction. And I'm just going to cover you up slightly again with Blossom, which I talked about last episode. This is my other project that I'm knitting on at the moment. It's Blossom by Marie Wallen, and it's got a tiny bit of ferrule, but most of it is done in intarsia. So it has been a little bit of an ordeal for me, I have to say. As you can see around the bottom, there are 10 small intarsia roses, and each rose has 5 different colors. So that means I had in it essentially 50 bobbins to work through. And I did it once and then I had to unpick it all because I was trying to weave my colours through at the same time. And it just made this section here, or the section of the roses, really just too tight and unflexible in comparison to the little bit of stocking stitch in between. So I had to really change that, unpick it all, do it all again. So it is a lot more flexible now. It's much better. I have to say it's not really I'm not super excited about this form of intarsia, and I think that's probably because I haven't found the most efficient technique to doing it. So it's not sort of doesn't have a rhythm to it. There's too much stopping and starting. What else can I say? I am not looking forward to darning in all the ends. It does look a little bit like a jellyfish at the moment, which is swimming in the sea, which is kind of fun. So I might call it my jellyfish jumper to keep me going at the moment. But I'm actually free sailing for a while with stocking stitch. And it's not so bad. And I totally love the end effect, the pictures.
So tell me, dolls, last episode you mentioned that you could buy these little bobbin things and you weren't going to do that and you just were going to wind them up yourself. Did that work? You don't regret that?
I would never buy the bobbins. The winding up is fine, but I actually didn't even need to do that. I only needed strands because the amount of stitches per strand was so small, you don't need a lot of yarn on your bobbin. So I just had it like that's why I call it my jellyfish.
Okay.
Had them hanging down like this.
Is it straightforward to figure out how much wool you need there?
Well, I've done over because I've finished and look, I've got all of this. So you really don't need that many. For example, for the red, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 stitches in total. So that's kind of typical.
So you could actually do a swatch and actually figure out how much you need of each colour and then do a pretty...
You exactly. could, and that would be a smart thing to do to practice... just to practice seeing how you went. As it was, I did a swatch of 10 of them and unpicked the whole lot.
That's an option.
So it is a smart thing to do. Definitely, I think I would totally recommend that. Just do a swatch. Sometimes I do get lazy. I do definitely swatch for everything, but...
But I think the issue here was that it's in the round and that means you... I know there are different ways of doing a swatch in the round.
Yes, okay. So I'm not purling on this because it's in the round. And if I was to do a straight swatch, I would be purling back.
Yeah.
That's true. But you can always, you just knit across, you cut off your yarn, you slide your stitches back to the end of the needle and you knit across again. So you're still only ever knitting in one direction. So you can always do a swatch that direction.
Okay.
That's what Alice Darmore recommends and that's how I always swatch for her, her projects.
Okay.
And that's what I did for this one. So that's coming on. It's just an easy knit now I'll be doing stocking stitch up to the armholes. On the sleeve cuffs, I've got a couple of intarsia roses on each cuff. Knit them, stocking stitch up, join it all in together with a few rows of intarsia and then five major intarsia roses. I am still enjoying it because it is something different. It's just difficult intarsia because there's little bits and pieces of it. You know, often you think of intarsia as just being blocks, simple blocks of colour. Yeah.
The top ones will probably be more easy.
Maybe, yeah.
They're a bit bigger. So it's less chopping around.
Quite possibly. But there's still, it's like there's fine shading. So you'll have a few stitches of the pink here and then a few stitches of the pink down here. And, you know, and I don't want to have new bobbins for those individual stitches. So I have to carry the threads at the back extra loosely, So there we go. That's under construction for today. And we're going to feature from the archives, which we very rarely do. Well, in the last three episodes, I think we haven't had time for it. But we are squeezing it in today. And it's what I'm wearing, which I knitted 8 years ago in 2008. And if I find, here it is down here, I knitted it from the Filati magazine, edition 35. And the one that I knitted was simply called number 27 pullover, which is rather unelegant and unimaginative.
Saving the creativity for the pattern there.
Exactly. But it is a really beautiful pattern. It was very easy to make, so it's just a nice sort of like a shell lace pattern up to here, and then you've got a yoke construction in stocking stitch that just sits really nicely across the shoulders and little armholes with, arm sleeves with arm sleeves. Sleeves. What do you call little cap sleeves? Cap sleeves.
Cap sleeves, little short sleeves.
Yeah, with lace. And there's sort of like a little scallopy edge on them, as you can see. The wool is the lana grossa cambia, which is 70% cotton and 30% polyamide. People sometimes ask me to give a rundown on how well my garments last over time. And I find that they all last really well. Like this is 8 years old. It looks brand new. You have to bear in mind that Germany has a summer of this long.
About 2 weeks.
So it's really, I have way less summer clothes than I do winter clothes. So it doesn't get that much wear. But in general, all the things that I make, they don't wear out. They might wear out here. It catches on my watch band.
Yeah, over time. Our watches are a bit dangerous.
But I'm talking like 10 years. But this is worn really well. I love it. And that's from the archives.
I picked up that it was 8 years ago. Can you remember what it was like knitting with that yarn?
Yes. It's...
Because generally you like knitting
stiff.
With wool.
Oh, yeah. I love to knit with wool. It's my absolute favourite. But if I want a design, then I'll knit with whatever I need to knit with to get the design. I'm design driven, actually.
Yeah.
And it is, I like it. I like the effect of it. It was a novelty yarn back then. I love these lovely light bits, the speckledy look in it. I think it's just a really elegant pattern.
Yeah, I think it's really smart. What I like is that it's got this yoke top and then the sort of lacy below.
It goes goes quite long. I don't know if I stand up. You may or may not see it.
Yeah, there you go.
But it just sort of goes quite long and it has a scalloped edge around here. So, yeah. Yeah, good.
Very smart.
Yes. It's now time for part two of the KNITSONIK interview. So we're going to say goodbye to you now and we'll see you again in 2 weeks' time. But first of all, we want to thank you very much for spending time with us today. We really appreciate it. And if you've really enjoyed the show, we would ask you to subscribe.
Yep. You can find us on... We're fruity knitting all around the place, Instagram, YouTube. There is a fruityknitting.com, Twitter. We're on Twitter. We're not very active on Twitter, but we are there. Come and say hello, leave your comments, subscribe where you can. We really appreciate your support and we look forward to seeing you in about 2 weeks and enjoy the rest of the interview.
A quick little reminder for our cull. We have the Fair Isle cull and the First Garment cull. And by the 31st of August, you have to get your 22nd selfie if you're going to participate into us. So just a reminder, don't do longer than 20 seconds if you can. It's best to keep it as short as possible. Otherwise, we'll have to edit it off. It's best if you don't put music behind it. We have to be very careful with copyright. So just say your name, show your wool, show what you've knitted so far, a big smile on your face, proud of your knitting, and then we're going to put it together as a collage to celebrate your knitting and your progress. So we're looking forward to getting that, and thank you very much to those who have already put it in for us. They're 20 seconds. Okay. And also I want to tell you that right at the end of this interview is a fantastic, hilarious musical treat. So enjoy.
All righty. Thanks very much and goodbye.
It's got KNITSONIK on it. It's got KNITSONIK on it.
Okay, so let's talk more about your book now, your KNITSONIK colourwork book. Because you're an academic and an artist, and these two things don't immediately come to mind as being practical or useful to the average person. But your book was created as a very practical and very useful guide to the average knitter. So where did the idea come from to start with?
I think it's really interesting, the kind of the perception that artists are impractical. And I think there's a mystique in how kind of art practice is represented generally. And I've always found that the only way to be an artist, the only way to survive as an artist is to be immensely practical. Because if you start, for example, by going, oh, I'm going to knit a speaker system and it's going to have 32 speakers and it's going to be like a big cloud of sound and you're going to walk into it. Like, you have to immediately begin making lists that are like source speakers, test maths of speakers, Czech speakers, and it very quickly becomes extremely practical, and you always run into problems along the way, and you always find that there's this lovely vision in your head, which is never what the final thing ends up being. And I was thinking about that. I've been thinking about that for years. And also when I became a knitter, or when I started knitting, I've mentioned these women who were in these amazing kind of publishing jobs for OUP. But since I've continued being a knitter, I have discovered there are so many women in this field, and men as well, but more women who are like coming from a physics background or an engineering background or a maths background, but are really, really uncomfortable with a creative process because they haven't had a training in it. It's not. And I think when you go to art college, you do get a very kind of, and for me, because I've done a degree and a PhD and an MA, and I've done loads of commissions, you do learn these really transferable skills about how to manage a creative process, how to start with an idea, how to proceed through it, and how to kind of resolve it when it goes horribly wrong, which it does all the time. And I think I was looking at the Alice Starmore book, the Ferrar knitting book that she has, and it has these beautiful little like photo of inspiration source, amazing piece of knitting, photo of inspiration source, amazing piece of knitting. And I was like, this is fine, I've been painting and drawing my whole life and I love color, I'm down with this, I can do this very easily. And then I just made, I think this was the first thing that I knitted, which was like my attempt at translating some blayberries in Scotland into stranded colour work. And there are some things that I like about it, like it's quite nice, this fadey action here, but this whole section here for me is not, I had a much nicer picture in my head of how this was going to turn out. And the leaf section, which I wanted to make it look really like organic and lovely, I was like, this is not what I meant when I started. And I was like, and also this was just looking really stripy, I didn't want this stripiness. And I did a few things like that where I just was like, I'm going to knit this into stranded colour work. And I just made such a kind of dog's dinner of it. And then when they said, you know, do you want to be the patron for Shetland Wool Week? And I said, yes, please, that would be amazing. They said, you know, would you like to do any classes? And I said, I thought to myself, do you know how to teach me how to make stranded colour work from everyday inspirations is to promise to give a class in it in like 6 months' time, because I have to sort it out. Like I have to learn how to do it if I'm going to teach a class. So then I suppose like the first swatch that I made was this one, which is based on the brickwork of Reading. And I did this really beautiful, precious, tidy little drawing, which I spent about like 10 hours perfectly colouring in the squares. And then I knitted this thing and I was like, do you know what, this is not useful, because if I bring this to a class, I'm just going to hold it up and say, this is my stranded colour work based on the bricks of Reading, and it's the exact same thing as the Alice Starmore book, that like all the exciting process of how I got to this happened in my head, where, you know, you can't see it if it's in my head. So I was like, right, what I need to do is get away from this little tiny, precious, perfect thing and start making big, exciting, exploratory swatches. So this is the brickwork revisited. And I think this is much more exciting because it's got areas that really work and then it's got areas that really don't work. Like, what is going on here? It's really, like, there was an experiment and I swiftly realised it wasn't working. And then here, this is interesting because one of the things that I talk about in the book is how to match colours to inspiration sources, because often you have an opinion in your mind of like, it's going to be this colour, and it totally isn't that colour. And the only way to check is to match. And that's exactly the same when you're painting. You're like, oh yes, I know how to mix a green colour, or I know how to mix a skin colour. And then you put it down and you're like, oh yeah, that's not what it looks like. And I think it's the same with matching the colours. So there's a bit here where on this one, I went outside, this is the bricks in my street, and I matched perfectly this lovely shade FC58 to the darker bricks in Reading. But the darker bricks have been fired in a special way that makes them shiny, so they really stand out. And in knitting, you don't have that different texture to differentiate that shape. So I realised, okay, I have to make more contrast and go a bit darker to bring out those diamondy shapes. So it was, and I kind of came up with all of these things for this class that I was going to teach in Shetland, and I made all these massive swatches. And then I realised, I taught the class and it was really lovely, and I just realised there is so much stuff that I've learned that I didn't get to say in this class. Maybe I should put it in a book. And I really felt like it was a book I wanted when I started making stranded colourwork from everyday things. Like when I designed this hat, it would have been so much better if I'd had my book to refer me to, the like, okay, so I start with some berries and I start with some leaves. And in the book I really try and break it down, because there's lots of things that are very restrictive and difficult about, I think this is the best swatch for showing the process. There's lots of things that are very restrictive about stranded colour work. First of all, it's a very low resolution medium. When you look at the world around you, it's like 10 trillion megapixels. And when you're looking at like stranded colour work, it's really like 7 dots per inch, to kind of give like a graphic comparison. And then secondly, there's infinite colours in the world around us, but in your knitting, there's really only, you're limited to the palette of yarn produced by your favourite purveyor of Shetland two-ply jumper weight, which I recommend for all stranded colour work. And with this swatch, I think this is, I always show people this one. So it's based on the tree in my garden, and I went outside and it was a really bright blue sunny day, and it was definitely this colour, the sky. It was like super saturated blue. And then these are the greens that I saw, and then I was looking and the bark of my walnut tree is a dead ringer for FC58 in the Jameson and Smith two-ply jumper weight yarn range. So I put them together, but as you can see, you really can't see what's going on there. Like it's kind of very confused, and the pattern doesn't stand out enough from the background. So very begrudgingly, I went to a lighter blue that wasn't the same amazing blue as the sky, and I put in some different kind of lighter shades that had the same warm green feeling about them but were lighter in value. And then I was like, oh, my tree just looks so fidgety and little, and it doesn't have the sturdy grandeur of the actual tree. So then I made all the lines thicker, and then I was like, oh, they've all just looked really square now. So and then I was just fed up with the tree for a little while. I thought, you know, I'll come back to you. And then I was experimenting with getting the leaves and the sense of light behind the leaves. And then this is a real close-up of the bark. And the bark has so many amazing colours in it. And I think this is how the KNITSONIK process has really grown out of, like the stranded colourwork process has really grown out of listening. Because I've spent so long listening to sounds that seem mundane or unimportant but actually are full of texture, that I've lost that cynicism that says, oh, that's rubbish, that's not worth doing something creative with. And so I will spend hours looking at bark and being like, these are the best colors for this bark on this tree. And so then I kind of refined, I was playing with the bark and I wanted a little bit more drama in, so you can see I went darker on the browns here. And then finally, I was ready after the little slight break, taking a break from the tree, I got back to it. And it's really, I'm really pleased with it now after all these iterations. But I thought, you know, this is really like, to show a creative process, you must make visible the errors and the mistakes that are a necessary part of it. So I really wanted to put wrong knitting, as I call it, in my book, and really get away from this kind of, I didn't want to put this in the book. I really wanted to put like lots of case studies and show people, no, it's really achievable. So
yes. And your book arrived in the mail a few days ago, and I've been reading it with a lot of pleasure in the last couple of days. And you do have these really great simple steps and systems for people to be able to analyse what has actually sort of gone wrong, or how they can change things so they have a better idea of what to change when they know it's not quite right. And I also thought, reading your book, I thought you could also have called it Zen and the Art of Stranded Colourwork because you do really emphasise right through the book about how we have all of these items, everyday items and things around us that we normally just think of as being very prosaic, or we pass them by, and your book is really about looking at them individually, taking time to consider them and study them, and seeing the endless poetry that's there, and then knitting it, you know. So it's like a painter teaches you how to paint your favourite items. You're teaching people to knit their favourite things and put them into garments or textiles that become very meaningful to them. Is that correct?
That is absolutely, absolutely what I'm trying to do. Because I think when you're doing a drawing or a painting, there's two kind of thoughts attached to that. One is that you are producing a drawing or a painting, and the other one is that you're engaging in the act of drawing or painting. And I love the act of knitting. I love creative process, and I love how once you've really... like with my walnut tree, I never can forget. Every time I go out in my garden, I can see, I acknowledge and I feel grateful for its amazing details, and I notice them. And I think that like one of the things that for me is the most positive feedback about my book is that people keep writing to me and saying, I'm seeing the world in a different way, and sending me little Instagrams of like, I'm waiting for the bus and I've just noticed this amazing configuration of colours. And I'm so happy if my book can give people this perspective on sourcing inspiration from everyday life. I hate this idea that you have to go to the special art gallery to have a special experience and then the rest of everything is just mundane and rubbish. I think the art gallery is a state of mind that you can bring with you. And I love, like, people are doing amazing stuff now with the KNITSONIK system. There's an amazing Japanese knitter called Yumi, who does amazing work.
Yeah.
And she's like, she's translating stuff like movies, and she's translating, you know, her favorite. She like, I think it was like a skin, some sort of cosmetic product, like either skin lotion or conditioner or something. And the design of the bottle, she like made this amazing tiny swatch based on it. And I just think like there's something very affirmative about creative processes that endear the everyday world to us, and that I wanted that philosophy to be in the book alongside this extremely practical kind of breaking it down focus on how to turn everyday things into beautiful stranded colour work. 'Cause it takes so long to knit a jumper, why not make it be really special and really particular to you?
Absolutely. And what a great way to give a gift when you know, when you have an idea or an object or something that you know is very dear to somebody, to translate that into stranded knitting and incorporate it in their gloves or on a hat or on a jumper, like you said. That's so personal.
There was a lady, there was quite a while back, she was making a jumper for somebody, and she ended up, she wrote this beautiful blog post about it. I'm just looking for it now. One of the swatches in my book is based on my favourite road, which is the A4074. It's an A road in Oxfordshire, and I've spent many, many hours driving between Reading, where I live, and Oxford, where I was studying. And this swatch is a kind of exploration of that road. And I think in the end, this is the part that I'm kind of happy with. So there's like all of this stuff that I don't really like, and then this bit. But she has done like a variation of this road chart, and the jumper is a kind of an expression of like a journey and her creative adventures. And she gave it to, I think it was either her son or her grandson, and I was so blown away by that, by this, and especially the way she'd done a story and the way that she'd taken my idea of knitting a journey and then appropriated it to her, the journey that she was particularly making that summer. It was beautiful. It's made my day.
And I just have to say to the viewers that this book is such a brilliant book because it's not just a how-to practical guide. It's also got all of these lovely little stories through it so that if you left it on your coffee table, you would find that not only your knitting friends would be interested in it, but probably even your partner who has never knitted would be very tempted to get up those needles, I think, pick up those needles. Because there's even a fantastic recipe for a fruitcake, which you based one of your designs on and is absolutely gorgeous. So I'm really keen to make that cake actually myself.
That is the fruitcake swatch.
Yeah, it's brilliant. And I love the way there's a design there which is like the fruitcake taken from a bird's eye view of it cut in slices, but then you've also got all of the texture of the cherries and the dried fruit inside.
Yeah, these tasty sections here and here. You have to spare a thought for my poor fiancé. We were on a train together and I was trying to understand this kind of like, how do I, like, this is ridiculous, maybe I'm pushing it too far. And I had about 50 photos of fruitcake on my phone and I was like scrolling through them, and then I suddenly had this eureka moment, which is that the edge of the fruitcake where it's caramelized is dark and the inside is light, and I was like, oh, that is the shading fixed for this. And I was like, observe the shading of the fruitcake. And he was like, I can't believe you're making me look at all these pictures of fruitcake and there's no fruitcake for me to eat. Poor Mark, oh. Long suffering.
Well, look, it's been so much fun today. I could sit and chat with you for hours and I think you've got so much that's interesting to share. So thank you so much for agreeing to be on the podcast. And I just want to wish you all the best of British luck with your KNITSONIK book. And and thank you for what you've done for the world of knitting.
Oh, thank you very much. And thanks so much for having me on Fruity Knitting Podcast.
Okay, so we'll say goodbye.
Bye.
Crimson and Smith Yarn Collection.
Do you need another glass of wine?
No, that won't help at this point.
All right.
But it is forthcoming.
I did pour you more.
You must. The song must come.
The song must come.
Yes.
9097 if you want to knit poppies. And definitely 54 if you want to knit mountains. There is some nice glistening in fountains that can be found in shade 1 or in shade 75. Do you feel alive? If you do, you should have 125. It's very bright and it makes you feel great. I've never found a good use for 8. I don't even know if there is a number 8. I don't think so. But if there was, we could make one and it would be great. The chords are very simple.
That's all right.
It's the lyrics.
The lyrics are brilliant.
A slideshow behind you of just a single ball of yarn with the number underneath each one.
And then I could just... FC14, you contain the very amazing mystery of tarmac in your very soul. No one knew there could be so many colours in tarmac, but you have them all.
36,
you're nearly black, but you're still blue. A little bit, I really love you. When I'm trying to knit biscuit tins that are very old, you're a lovely warm blue, you're dark and not cold. 2020, I love you. You are the cream in my strawberries. You are the
strawberries.
Rhymed way into a corner.
Oh, yeah, I did, didn't I? 2020, I really love you. You are cream, you are beige, you are anything I need you to be. You are always harmonizing nicely. You're the best guest at my yarn party. You play nice with all the other colors and you never draw attention to yourself. 2020, you are really awesome. FC11, you're always making everybody want to knit an elf. You're so green, you're like a leprechaun, you're like a hill, you're like a mountain, you are like the spring. You've got yellow, you've got green, you've got things I've never seen, but you are always very bright and lively in my knitting.
121.
You are the cover of my electricity book. You're like mustard that I left in the fridge for too long. You're like a banana that's got a little bit of soot on it. But I like you for some things, you are just the one. And you're very good with number 28 and with 23. If you just need a lift of lemon in your knitting, then you can always mix it with 91. You are the very colour of sultanas. Who would have known it until I went into my kitchen and matched you up with all of my dried fruit and the apricots were 91 and so were the egg yolks. But the prunes, they were 81.
Really?
Not FC55, as I had previously assumed. They would be where you have to hold up the colours just to see. '54, you are the graphite in a nice HB pencil. Nothing rhymes with pencil except stencil. Actually, I've never coloured much of my accordion.
Oh,
seriously?
Oh, yeah. That's pretty good.
It's kind of pearlescent. It's a little bit 93 there.
Yeah, well, yeah. Right there along the
All
keyboard.
Right, come on. Add that verse to the Jameson and Smith song.
It becomes too self-referential, though.
It's meta, Felix.
It is meta.
Meta.
Accordion, you are 1403 and 93, which is also the colour of the stop sign and also the colour of the jam in a jammy dodger. If it's one, a really, really cheap one made of fake strawberry.
Fake strawberry again.
I know, I keep pacing myself into a corner with the strawberry. 141. You are the one. I have spent the entire weekend trying to find things that with you will look fun and also make a reference to my fantastic fabric from my friend, which is a little bit like 141 but a bit more minty, which as we've previously discussed is not represented anywhere in the Jameson Smith shades.
No, it is not.
Shade 2, you are the lovely colour of warm old mortar, the colour of lovely old concrete. But no palette is complete without a little bit of 203, a very nice soft warm grey, the colour of a miserable sky on a grey day. And I'm sure there's something else that rhymes with A, but I can't think of it right now. Oh, I have to write a proper song. I have to sit
you
down
really
and write
do.
A song.
With 90 verses.
90 verses!
90 verses. And a chorus that gets sung after every verse. Okay, after every second verse.
Yeah.
Maybe every four.
J and S, we all say yes. J and S, we all say yes. That could be the chorus. Very simple. We need it to be quick since it's going to be 91
verses. But you could maybe...
92 with one for the non-existent minty.
Non-existent minty.
Number 8.
Number 8 that does not exist.